It is clearly understood in business that while you might have the greatest product in the world, it needs to be marketed successfully to guarantee commercial success. While the Apple has been recognized as an innovative developer of a range of products and services, it is the approach to marketing that is the final, significant ingredient for success.
iPods here!
The secret to Apple's success lay in the brand's holistic and integrated marketing communication strategy, which stressed upon the brand's identity of simplicity, style, and love of music right from the very beginning, starting from the launch of the product by Apple's iconic CEO, Steve Jobs.
The field that we decided to do it in, the choice we made, was music. Now, why music? Well, we love music. And it's always good to do something you love. And that's where we want to be. That is where we want to be. And we are introducing a product today that takes us exactly there. And that product is called iPod. iMac, iBook, iPod. Boom. That's iPod. I happen to have one right here in my pocket, matter of fact. There it is, right there. So, this amazing little device holds 1,000 songs, and it goes right in my pocket.
Every great product needs a stroke of good luck. For the iPod, it was the purely accidental supply of white earphones that would become the first step in turning the product into a cultural phenomenon.
But it would be a stroke of pure luck that made everyone else take notice.
When the iPod first came out, it was, of course, Macintosh-only fans, younger people, urban people, began to see for the first time these white earbuds. White earbuds. No company had ever cared before about the color of the darn earbuds. But all of a sudden, that became a symbol, and people are like, what is that?
They made the earbuds white. Just because the player was white, they wanted to keep consistent with the color of the player. But it turned out to be a brilliant piece of marketing because it advertised a player that's normally hidden in a pocket or a backpack, something that's invisible, something you don't see, and it made it very visible.
You're walking down the street, you see a cool person, and you see some visible accessory that you've never seen before. And you think, what's that, and why is that guy wearing it? And then you see it again, and then you see it again, and then suddenly you start taking notice that every person I see with those white earbuds is a cool-looking person. And then you start really wanting it. You want to be part of that community.
Now, Apple picked up on that and noticed that the cool people had the white earbuds, and they began to put it into their advertising. The white earbuds became the hero, the piece of iconography that said, this is who we are, and you belong if you have one of these.
The iPod's TV ads, which were designed by New York-based ad agency Chiat Day, quickly became the stuff advertising legends were made of. The slouched, white earbudded dancer became an iconic image in the world media.
Hey mama, it's that beat that make you move, mama. Get on the floor and move your booty, mama. So come on, mama, dance to the drummer.
Apple roped in some of the biggest names from the music industry to endorse the iPod. From their mainstay, U2. To Eminem.
Snap back to reality.
To Bob Dylan. Will Ferrell.
iPod. iPod's here.
I think it's like 2 million songs. My name is Will Ferrell. And I'm a porn actor.
And unofficially, even George W. Bush.
The music.
The iPod ads also included a healthy dose of
plants. I can't tell if it's positive or negative.
What's up?
iPod Shuffle.
So, am I pregnant then, or?
Yeah. Yeah, I'm pregnant. It's a boy.
Oh my gosh! Oh my God!
The dancer was also featured prominently in the iPod's print ads. Keeping in mind the target audience, the ads were colorful, vibrant, and full of energy. So no one could doubt that the silhouetted figures were in fact dancing to the beats of the iPod.
Oh. I never meant to cause you trouble.
Apple used a technique called wraparound advertising, wherein huge structures such as trains and buildings were entirely covered in iPod ads. Just when it looked like things couldn't get any better with the iPod, Steve Jobs and Apple surprised us all yet again by launching a product experience like none other. The implementation of iTunes wasn't just a master marketing move. Steve Jobs had single-handedly reinvented the digital music industry, providing a solution acceptable to both record labels and music fans.
On April 28, 2003, after months of exhaustive wrangling with executives and artists, Apple launches the iTunes Music Store. With more than 200,000 songs from all five major labels, Steve's idea has become a reality. Steve's hard work pays off. Within just 5 days of launching the iTunes Music Store, Apple sells more than 1 million songs. Steve Jobs and Apple had accomplished something no other company had done: offer consumers a digital music player with its own dedicated music store.
Apple then engaged in a relatively new and clever promotion strategy known as cross-promotion, which involves the use of one product to support another and vice versa. Some of the clearest examples are iPod's associations with BMW and Nike. In this case, Apple actually got other firms to do their marketing for iPod. Consider this BMW ad.
BMW introduces the first seamless integration of iPod and automobile.
And this Nike ad.
Letter to go.
Completed.
The strength of the product, backed by a strong marketing ethic, provided an irresistible combination, making the iPod an unstoppable force in markets all over the world. Apple's top management had cleverly used all marketing channels available at their disposal to enhance the iPod's brand value by constantly stressing the brand's core values of simplicity, style, and love of music.